going to be reading from Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then we will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and we will separate people from one another as a shepherd. Separate the sheep from the goat, and we will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you are blessed by my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you and from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it we saw you as a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothes? And when was it when we saw you were sick in prison and we visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did to one of the least of these, you are a member of my family, and you did it to me." Then he said to those at the left hand, "But you are accursed, departed from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. For I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me in. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I will tell you, just as you did not do it for the one of the least of these, you did not do it for me." And these will go away into eternal fire of punishment, but the righteousness into the eternal light. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. I want to thank George for offering to bring a message this morning. He is our outreach coordinator and has been, just briefly, it's been less than a year, and he's taken on quite a few of the programs of the church and is helping us to reach the community, and he'll now talk to us about that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oftentimes, I've said to Chris, that message you gave today was awesome. And the reason was because you stepped away from the pulpit.
So like once.
That's been further backed up as I've gotten other people to also tell Chris, some of your best messages have been when you stepped away from the pulpit. So when I approached him and asked him about coming up here and speaking, he was happy, glad, he read the outline, he said, awesome. However, there's one condition. You've got to step away from the pulpit when you give this message. So what he doesn't know is we compromised.
And I'm stepping away from the pulpit.
However, bringing my notes with me. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, I ask that you speak into my heart as the loud comes out of my mouth to be reflective of your love. Please allow those here to hear these words and to understand that it is you that speaks them. We love you and we thank you for your love. In your Son's holy and precious name, Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
So, life is not just about me or you. We are to go beyond ourselves to reach out, to give comfort to those that are hurting, to give supplies to those that are needy, and to give the word of God to those who are without it, or desiring to know him more. Jesus said, I believe it was in Acts 20, verse 35, that it is more blessed to give than receive. And we will never know how blessed life can be unless we reach out with the love of God to the world around us. I want to play a little video clip here. Get it started. Wait.
No debate.
Well, maybe it's small now. And each point that I make will be backed up by Scripture. Now, to make it even easier for me, I've brought my voice-activated Scripture reader. All right. It doesn't hang in our building, nor can we send it through the mail. Our most powerful outreach tool is us. It's me, it's you. It's members of our congregation, our community. Our challenge is to unleash our outreach power and reach our full potential in Christ so we can effectively outreach to everyone. Church, after all, is people. It's not stuff. It's not the roof. It's not the walls. It's the people. Simply put, outreach is meeting the needs of our community and world while expressing God's love in ways that build relationships and share God's plan of salvation. So, my 10 points is, why is outreach vital? Why is it essential? And why it's a must. Point number one, outreach is essential to our church because it is important to God, and that makes it important to every Christian.
Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.
Point number two, outreach was commanded by Christ. Before his ascension, Jesus told the disciples that their impact on the world should start in their city and expand its influence into the entire world.
Matthew 28:19. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Point number three. Outreach is necessary for growth. Worship, discipleship, and serving are essential, but if you never progress to the next stage by being involved in outreach, you will be spiritually lacking and incomplete. If one is truly walking with God in discipleship, worship, and service, then outreach will be a natural result.
John 15:8. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples.
Point number four. Outreach both glorifies and pleases God. Jesus told us that God is glorified when we bear fruit by reaching out to others.
1 Timothy 2, verses 3 through 4. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth.
Point number five. Outreach models the life of Christ in meeting needs. Jesus taught us that serving others is the same as serving Christ himself.
2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance.
Point number six. Outreach is needed for the survival of Christ's church. Without the reproduction of faith, the body of Christ would cease to exist.
Luke 15:7. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent.
Point number seven. Outreach is necessary to reach the world. Of the 7 billion plus people in our world, 2 billion live in unreached people groups with no access to the good news about Christ. Two-thirds of the world's population are lost without Christ and will not know him unless Christians fulfill their obligation to go and tell the good news of Jesus Christ.
Matthew 28:19. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Romans 10:14. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?
Point number eight. Outreach results in God's blessing and favor on our lives. It is very clear that God intends to bless those whose hearts are focused on reaching out to lost and hurting people. God clearly affirms those who share his passionate heart for reaching out to those who do not know him.
Luke 6:38. Give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For the measure you use, it will be measured to you.
Point number nine. Outreach requires synergy or interaction. Loving our community and world will require individual and organizational cooperation. It calls each of us to set aside our individual preferences and combine our time, talents, and treasures.
Ecclesiastes 4:9. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor.
My final point, and I got a little story about this one. One of our outreach programs is community service for those individuals that have done indiscretions in their life. So the court mandates a certain amount of hours that people got to go out and serve. So there's a young man in my life who had community service, and he was explaining to me what it was that he did that night. And he said, I was at a church and breaking down tables and chairs and sweeping up and stuff like that. And immediately my board of trustee hat went on. And I thought, wow, free labor. How can I get some of this free labor? So I talked to him some more. I got his contact guy's name. I called the court system, filled out the applications, did the interview, and before I know it, I had young men and women assigned to me to become free labor to work at the church. Clean stuff, paint stuff, all 9 yards. So it was one of the young men assigned to me. He was about 50 hours into his service. He had carried bags of food, dishes, and loads. He had come here to coffee houses, set up equipment, broke down tables and chairs. And he was a about into his 50th hour of time served when, after one of our breakdowns here, he stepped up to me and he said, "Hey, George, I've got a question. Could you show me around the church? Because I think I would be interested in bringing my dad here to go to service on Sunday." And it was at that point that it struck me, it hit me in the back of the head, a big hand slap, that was not about free labor. This was about outreach. We actually managed to touch the life of an individual, and it never even really hit me. Or I never even thought to take community service mandated by a court and turn that into an outreach program and touch somebody's life. Backed up by scripture.
Proverbs 14:31. Anyone who oppresses the poor is insulting God who made them. To help the poor is to honor God.
Thanks, Beth. As church leadership and members, we have a responsibility to encourage and empower people and ourselves toward a loving relationship with God through Jesus Christ. While direct mail, advertising, and other promotional efforts can be very effective, and they are, the guest who walks through our door at the invitation of a friend or family member is most likely to become a part of our church and the body of Christ. This is because, real simple, they already have a relational connection. I'm going to ask George and Jonathan,
here you are,
pass out these cards. I'm going to explain. So, there are about, interesting number, 100 million unchurched individuals living in the United States. 100 million. 40 million of them would be willing to come to church if they were invited or felt welcome. 40 million. Now look, I'm not asking you to bring 40 million to church. People to church next Sunday. Well, we're going to need a new boat. So, my helpers here are handing out invite cards. And this is real simple and easy. I'm asking you, actually, Jesus Christ is commanding you to go out and invite somebody to church. You don't even have to talk. Hand them the card. All the information is on the card. If you feel as if you've got more than one person in your life that you want to invite, these cards will be stacked up in the back of the new church. Grab as many as you want. Invite a family member, a neighbor, a coworker, somebody that you don't have a good relationship with. Invite them to church. Get them here. Also, when we bring new people to church, the visitors come in for the first time, and we do a really great job with this. We greet them, we introduce ourselves, we talk to them, we make them feel welcome. On top of that, what we're going to do, and what we have, in fact, we started today with it, we have created a visitor welcome box. So, you know, within the box, and thanking them for coming, there's some candy, Chris's contact information, and a $5 gift card to Chick-fil-A.
And no, you cannot pretend you're
So, Chris and Linda will have these in the back. The folks may be able to determine who's new here. I hope. If you happen to bring someone to church and you manage to sneak out of here without one of these, please track them down and make sure they get one. So, We have a number of programs here at the church. In fact, it's actually mind-boggling. When I sat down and started wrapping my arms around outreach and realized all of the things that we've got going on, it's just incredible. And I can sit up here, stand up here, and I can steal off this whole list. And if you're anything like me, you're the first one and forget the next one. And then by the time you get to the next one, you'll forget the first one. So as I'm discussing what we have available, my help us again. I wrote down most of the programs that we have here. When I got done printing these cards and I had to hand these things one at a time on the printer, I bought 500 cards and managed to get like 150 of them printed out because they were coming out cockeyed and information was missing and stuff like that. We have an outreach committee here, sort of official, unofficial, that's comprised of about five members. I have myself, Chris, Linda, our pointy head and spear, Kate Winter, who gets most of the phone calls and emails and stuff like that. And Barb Hardison also. So it's our prayer that we can add more members to that. We're looking for ideas, information, other outreach programs that we can do, things that we can get our fingers in, how we can outreach to the community to bring Jesus Christ into people's lives. So it's our prayer. We have about 300 registered people in our church. We're hoping to put together a committee of 300 people. In the very near future, we're going to have a meeting, probably in September. I invite you to attend if you want to get involved. The cards we just passed out. If you can't make the meeting, but you want to be involved, my phone number is on there, my email is on there, contact me. If you're interested in getting involved in any other program that we have here, I listed your name next to that outreach. The meeting that we're going to have, like I said, we're going to discuss programs, ideas. We have money available to us. Yeah, here it comes. Don't get me wrong here, I'm not asking for money. What I'm asking here is you. I want you. I want your neighbor. I want your family. I want you to go to work. I want you to be involved in outreach. Commanded by Christ. I had a member of my family, an in-law, who heard about what we did here at the church because of his schedule. He's unable to attend church, but he wanted to be involved. Sitting in my kitchen one day, he handed me a check. And I looked at it. He says, "That's for your outreach thing that happened. I know you feed people, you clothe people, you provide your time, your talents. You can't make it to church, but I want to give you this check." So I took the check, and I looked at it and said, "Ah, thanks a lot. It's really, really nice." And then I looked at it again and realized I missed a zero. So I was floored that he had the thought, idea to help out this church and what we do here. And, it's by the grace of God that we have been able to run all of these programs that we got with minimal amount of dollars. God is providing. 7 times 7, he's doing it all the time. I don't want your money. Alright. Dwayne?
Yes.
Let's Let's find out when we shook our fist at heaven and said, God, why don't you do something? And he said, I did. What did he say? Sooner or later, you will need to sow the seeds of faith and reach out to those